الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمدك اللهم سبحانك كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. نحمدك اللهم آناء الليل وأطراف النهار، معترفين بسلطانك، حامدين شاكرين لنعمائك. ندعو الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يديم علينا نعمه ظاهرة وباطنة، وأن يلهمنا العزم والعزيمة والصبر والثبات على أن نحمده على تلك النعماء. اللهم أمين. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يحيي ويميت، وهو حي لا يموت، وهو على كل شيء قدير، شهادة قامت بها السماوات والأرض. ندعو الله سبحانه وتعالى ألا يحرمنا إياها لحظة لقائه. اللهم أمين. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. اللهم جزه عنا خير ما تجزي به مرسلا ونبيا. اللهم شفعه فينا شفاعة لا نعذب بعدها أبدا. اللهم اسقنا من حوضه شربة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم طب القلوب ودواؤها، وعافية الأبدان وشفاؤها، ونور الأبصار وضياؤها. صلى عليك الله يا علم الهدى، ما هبت النسائم وما ناحت على الأيك الحمائم. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, our dear sons and daughters, the future of Islam, inshaAllah Rabbil Alameen. The lunar year, السنة الهجرية المباركة, 1440. To celebrate, to recognize, to be so happy about it, to farewell one year and to have a good assessment and evaluation to what we have done, and to welcome another one to plan, inshaAllah Rabbil Alameen, ahead of us in order to have another great year, inshaAllah Rabbil Alameen, in our life. Most importantly, as I shared with you before, what we can learn from that hijrah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah after spending 13 years in Mecca, was struggling and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not even winning the hearts of 100 of the Sahaba, radwanullah alayhim ajma'in, but less, subhanallah. And you might be wondering, why that? Why that few number? Keep in mind, subhanallah, as I have shared with you before, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in those 13 years was struggling and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, till the order and the command came from Allah for him to migrate from Mecca to Al-Madinah and establish a new place and a new state there under his leadership. What he has suffered back in Mecca, comparing to your suffering before you came to this country, it is not comparable. Wallahi at all. Think about it. I decided to leave my hometown to come to here in order to, whatever the reason is or reasons are. How much you suffered? How much Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam suffered? How much of the Sahaba have suffered? One. Two. What was his plan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Mecca to Al-Madinah, migrating from Mecca to Al-Madinah along with the Sahaba, establish the first Islamic state, to have the best Muslim community ever, to spend another 10 years for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order for Islam to reach us here in this country. After you migrated from your own hometown, your country, wherever you came from, what is your plan? Money, work, job, education, married, children, have a nice life, much better than before. All of the above are okay, no problem. But have one major goal in your life, wallahi, migrating from wherever you come to here, your deen, your Islam, Allah and Rasulullah, first and foremost, first. And then anything else would come. But, يعني, جددوا النية مع الله, renew your intention with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala since you came here. Maybe it was for some other things, but you are not aware of what I am saying now. Now, renew your intention and say, I am here for Allah first and foremost, for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first and foremost, for deen, for Islam, and then anything else would come, wallahi. And you'll find out that anything you wanted to do would go in a much easier way, more successful way, more elegant way. Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. And instead of saying, I'm here for this and that, and I'm really struggling and striving, I cannot accomplish anything. Because the first goal of coming here, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first goal for him, migrating from Mecca to Al-Madinah, Islam. The same thing we have to do. No difference whatsoever, wallahi. And the least they would say, live as a real Muslim and a real mu'min in this land. Abide by the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow what Islam exactly telling you and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You'll be the best of the best human being ever. And you'll find people taking you as a role model. That's it. We're not asking you to establish a new Islamic state in here, you know. Live as a Muslim, as a mu'min, first and foremost. That's it. And it is not that difficult, wallahi, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. To continue his struggling and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala today and share with you some other things he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had suffered, as I shared with you last week, many things, subhanallah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had all of those temptation, all of those tests, all of those ibtilaat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with money, with wealth, with highest prestige ever, offering him some treatment because he's not doing well according to their wish, and that convincing my Abu Talib to leave Islam, do something else, it's no. And then for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam personally to have Abu Talib passed away and Khadija passed away, yet he is for Allah and for Islam. That's it. That's him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a lot of people would say, wallahi, enough is enough. He did his best. And now it is time to give up. No, wallahi. Never. Whatever the difficulties you're facing in your life as a Muslim, as a mu'min, the challenges, the ibtila'at, never give up. Keep going. Keep working. Have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deeply penetrated in your heart and your mind and your soul. وتوكل على الله. Totally dependent on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do your best. And you'll see the result. You'll see the result. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided to do something else. Meccan people, the Qurayshid people, the pagans, the kuffar, the disbelievers are not really coming forward to Islam. So he thought, maybe somewhere else, some other people. Let me try to go somewhere else, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, instead of just staying in Mecca. So he decided to move to At-Ta'if, the second largest town in Arabia at that time in terms of trade, business, and acts of worship. But still worshipping idols like the Meccan people, people in Mecca. But he said, let me try. I won't lose anything. Maybe they would be more lenient to come to Islam and to abide by the teaching of Islam and so on and so forth. Once he went there, thinking the leadership of a Ta'if, people would welcome him or at least communicate with him or have a discussion with him. No. None whatsoever of the leadership of a Ta'if people to come to talk to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Instead, sending to him their children. their children, and equipped enough with as many stones as they can carry to stone Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his face and his body, along with his servant Zayd ibn Haritha, till the blood was all over. Yani it's mainly you children, kill him if you can. Allah, when you think about that situation and say, Ya Allah, يعني, هذا رسولك وهذا نبيك, this is your prophet and your messenger. How come this would happen to him? How come little kids to stone Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is there any reason behind that? Is there any wisdom? Yes, there is. There is. In your life as a Muslim, as a mu'min, tests from Allah, trial from Allah, ibtila from Allah, ikhtibar from Allah, never stop. It will come always to you for Allah to test your iman, your connectedness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You never give up. You never ask. You never question, ask, why me, Allah? I see some people around me that are not even Muslim, but they are living much better life. No, Allah, I don't think this way. Allah is testing you in order to pass this test, in order to give you more than what you were expecting from him. And this is what happened with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we're learning from him. So he said, by the garden there of Bani Rabi'ah, just waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help, to support, to guide. But while he's sitting there, subhanAllah, Rabbil Alameen, what came to his mind, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? A wonderful statement and a dua. I would love for all of you to share with me the deep meaning of that dua he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made. In order to learn in your life as well, when you are in a difficulty, like what Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had to say, this is the way of Allah. This is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ilayka ashku dha'fa quwwati wa qillat hilati wa hawani 'ala an-nas ya arhamar rahimin anta rabbul mustada'afina wa anta rabbi ila man takiluni ila ba'idin yatajahhamuni am ila aduwwin malaktahu amri إن لم يكن بك غضب علي فلو أوالي غير أن عافيتك هي أوسع لي. أعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وصلح عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة أن يحل علي غضبك أو ينزل بي سخطك. لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. الله أكبر يا رسول الله. Maybe the first reaction anyone would have when you are in a situation like that situation Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in, when you see little kids are stoning you. Yeah, maybe the first reaction as a human may say, Ya Allah, take care of them or have a revenge against them. Or help me to take care of them in order to revenge, in order to seek some. But no. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not go this way, but instead going to Allah, and you're the only one I can rely on to share with you how weak I am in that point. You, Allah, and you know how weak I am in that point. I cannot do anything. And you have seen that humiliation to me, coming even from little children in a Ta'if, in that town there. You are the most gracious, most merciful. Most gracious. Remember, stoning and blood. You are the most gracious and most merciful. And you are the Lord of those who are weakened on earth. أنت رب المستضعفين. And you are my Lord. You are in the most difficult situation ever in your life. The most devastating situation ever in your life. One word of two letters. You say it. Ya Rab. Ya Rab. Easy for a lot of people, most difficult situation, 911. Some other people, dad, mom, brother, sister, friend, community, leaders, imam, help, help, help. Allah. First thing. Ya Rab. Ya Rab. أنت رب المستضعفين وأنت ربي إلى من تكلني. To whom I can seek some help and refuge. It's only you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Should I go and seek some help from someone who's far away from me to help me and guide me? Or to one of the enemies who do have the upper hand and have the power and have the authority to ask them to seek refuge from them? No, it is you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only concern I do have, Ya Allah, are you pleased with me? Are you happy with me? Did I do my job so far? 12 years of struggling and striving, and now little kids are stoning me. Are you still pleased with me? Or I'm missing something I should do, I'm not aware of. Guide me to it. It is you and your help and your guidance and your support to me I would seek refuge in, and I would have your light of your face that has been enlightened the whole darkness of the whole world, and everything went okay perfectly because of the light of your face, Ya Allah. This is what I'm seeking. This is what I'm looking for. You're having that the darkest point in your life ever. Think of the light of the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enlighten your way in life. Never think of that darkness, because it is man-made darkness. For the light of the face of Allah, it is Allah's light. And compare both. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have to take, we have to learn from, we have to follow. Asking you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, never, I'm asking and I'm begging you, Allah, to send your wrath on me, or your unpleasure on me. You're the only one on whom I can rely heavily. I can be dependent heavily. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَةَ إِلَّا بِكَ. No power, no authority. Nothing in this whole universe except by you. By the garden, there, very weak, powerless, nothing, along with his servant, the other one I would like to share with you as well. That's what he said in a difficulty, in a situation like this. And I would love for you, inshallah, and to learn from it as much as you can, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, الذي خلقني ولم أكو شيئا. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to you, Allah, that you have created me while I was nothing. Before I was born, before you were born, what you were, what I were, nothing. And then later, yani, sperm and egg, and then me. I praise you, Allah, for that. اللهم أعني على هول الدنيا وبوائق الظهر ومصائب الليالي والأيام. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guide me, Ya Allah. All of those difficulties, all of those hardships, all of those problems in this dunya, what I have been tested by, and all of those things coming day and light to me in order to test me. Allahumma sahubni fi safari. Ya Allah, be my greatest companion ever in my traveling, in my traveling. Wakhlufni fi ahli. You're the only one for taking care of my family members while I'm gone for the sake of you. وعلى صالح خلقي فقومني. You straighten me up in the best manner ever coming from you and your guidance. وإليك ربي فحببني. Make me love you the most ever. Make me love you the most ever. وإليك فحببني. وإلى الناس فلا تكلني. Never put me in a situation to be dependent on people. I have good friends, no doubt about it. Take some help, no doubt about it. But the only one you have to be heavily dependent on, first and foremost, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أنت رب المستضعفين وأنت ربي. You are the one who are the Lord of those people who are weak in a situation, weak situation like this, and you are my Lord, Ya Allah. And again, I seek refuge from you. Help me, guide me to the best ever. Inshallah, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that situation. Yet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may be in a fraction, of a fraction of second, would make all of those kids who are stoning him to be gone just like this. But no. For him to learn sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and for us to learn. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that moment. Muhammad. سَأُطْبِقُ عَلَيْهِمِ الْأَخْشَبَيْنَ إِنْ أَرَدْتَ. I will give the order to the most humongous mountains in Arabia at that time to destroy all of them. Yani, as a human being, and I'm seeking revenge and see what they have done for me, I would say, Jibreel, go ahead and do it. It's a golden opportunity if you seek revenge. But for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, telling Jibreel what, answering him how, replying to him how, la ya Jibreel. No, Jibreel, don't do that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yukhruju min aslabihim man ya'budu Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar ya Muhammad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring out of them their offspring who can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seeking revenge in the manner of prophets, no. For us, no. Leave it for Allah. Anything happening to you, in this world, any difficulties, any problem, any challenge, any dhulm, any oppression, any suppression, leave it to Allah. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take care of it. Leave it for Allah, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. طب couldn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some security, some forces, some tanks, some Apache, something in order to take care of him, not to let even children, kids to stone him? No. Allah wants to save the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a human being. He deal with that situation himself without any help coming from anywhere except the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn this. طيب. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew deeply in his heart and his mind and his soul, Allah will accept his dua. Definitely without any doubt. But now, okay, Zayd ibn Haritha, my servant, myself, were in a Ta'if. Let's go back to Mecca. We did our best in a Ta'if, and this is the result, this is the outcome, this is what we have seen. Let's go back to Mecca. in order to see, يعني, for the rest of our life, what will be doing. Trying to re-enter Mecca, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What happened? What happened? This is what we'll see, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, in a minute. لازلنا في رحاب المصطفى. البر لا يبلى والذنب لا ينسى والديان لا يموت. كل ابن آدم خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون والتائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له. ادعوا الله وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأصلي وأسلم على رسول الله صلاة وتسليما يليقان بالحبيب المصطفى النبي المجتبى صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وتابعيه وتابعي تابعيه إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, our children, the future of Islam, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, Allahumma Ameen. We're with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reaching the boundaries of Mecca, coming from At-Ta'if, trying to re-enter Mecca. Muhammad and your servant Zayd, no re-entry to Mecca. You're not allowed to come back to Mecca. You stay where you were. Sounds familiar to you. I'm traveling and I want to re-enter anywhere, yani. No, sir. No re-entry. No visa. No. It's a good reminder, wallahi. It's a good reminder. Even Rasulullah, no re-entry to his birthplace, to the birth of Islam place, did nothing to them. No retaliation, no fighting, no nothing during all of those 12 years. No. Till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send to him Al-Mut'am ibn Uday, kafir, non-believer, never came to Islam, never say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, telling the Quraysh people, the enemies of Islam, all the pagans, I would challenge all of you, Muhammad will come back, will re-enter Mecca under my protection. I will grant him asylum back to Mecca. And he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send you forces. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَمَا هِيَ إِلَّا ذِكْرًا لِلْبَشَرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you are in the most difficult situation ever in your life, the biggest challenge ever, Allah will send you His own forces in order to help you, support you, and bring you to the right way. Here's Al-Mut'am ibn Uday. And none of the leadership of Quraysh at that time could it challenge Al-Mus'ab, Al-Mut'am. As a one person, yani easily for him, wallahi, if they give the order to be killed, he would be killed. He would be vanished. Or disobey him. Or say, who you are, we don't care about what you're saying. Muhammad is not going to come back. No re-entry to Muhammad. But look when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been employed His own forces in order to support Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Maybe you are in a situation you never think of any of those forces of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you in a situation where you're having hardship and problem. Allah will send it to you immediately to help you, and you think, how it happened? This is not your business. This is the business of Allah, because He loves you, because you're heavily dependent on Him. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, re-enter Mecca, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. That now I'm back to Mecca, birthplace of Islam, my birthplace, and with own people, my tribe, calling me Majnoon, idiot, crazy, lost my mind, never listened to me, never adhered to Islam, still worshipping 360 idols, inside the Kaaba, what else, Ya Allah, I can do? The miracle, the gift, the support for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for struggling all of those years, al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. The night journey, the miracle to you, Muhammad, from your bed. You're riding that animal to go to Jerusalem. How long will it take? How you're going to do it? How safe, how secure? But you will do it. And you will be there. And will resurrect all the prophets and messengers. In al-Masjid al-Aqsa. To pray behind you. Not for anyone to lead. You're the one who would lead. All of them. And from there to the heaven. To the seventh. And beyond. To meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in al-Mi'raj. And from there, coming back to Mecca. That's your gift. That's your reward. For those struggling and striving for 12 years continuously, tirelessly. Wait for a gift from Allah to you for what you have been doing for Islam and for Allah. You will receive it, wallah. You will receive a gift sometime, somehow, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He did with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Allah never forget us. It was a gift to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with al-Isra al-Mi'raj. This is the miracle. With all of the details of it, inshallah, we'll come to it sometime. But how about the Ummah of Muhammad, us? Is there any gift for us, Ya Allah, Yani? Is there anything you have for those less than 100 people in Mecca believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And the rest of us, 1.8 billion today, is there any gift, Ya Allah, because of what we have been working for you, struggling and striving? Yes! What, Ya Allah? As-salah. To be the only pillar of Islam, out of the five pillars of Islam, to be prescribed to us Muslims from the heavens, coming from Allah directly to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and from Muhammad to us, not to be revealed in revelation in Quran as a wahi by Jibreel. As-salah is our gift in order to communicate with Allah. Five times a day, in order to see Him, in order to ask Him, to seek His help and support and guidance. Salah. A reward, a wonderful gift from Allah. Never give up. Whatever the difficulty you're having, keep struggling and striving, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you as much as you wish, not according to your wish, but according to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one thing for Him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one for us, after all of those struggling and striving. Then it would come to the hijrah. Muhammad, don't stay in Mecca anymore along with your Sahaba. You go to Al-Madinah. You establish